على محمد وآله وصحبه أما بعد. My dear brothers, my Salafi brothers and sisters, inshallah ta'ala, this is going to be part three of our talk in regards to the affairs that have to do with Al-Hajj, Umrah and Al-Hajj. And in this lesson, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to study together the nine prohibited things during Al-Ihram from the book of Sheikh Salih bin Fawzan al-Fawzan, حفظه الله تعالى, الملخص الفقهي, the summary of Islamic jurisprudence. Sheikh Salih bin Fawzan al-Fawzan, he said, there are specific forbidden acts that a pilgrim should avoid while being in a state of ihram, a state of ritual consecration during Hajj or Umrah. These prohibited acts are nine. First, it is prohibited during ihram to cut, shave, pluck out, or remove any kind of hair from one's body without a legal excuse. For Allah, exalted be He, says, the meaning of which, and do not shave your head until the sacrificial animal has reached its place of slaughter. This is in Surah Al-Baqarah, Ayah 196. As shown in the verse, Allah prohibits pilgrims to shave their heads while being in a state of ihram. And this is in turn applies to all kinds of hair in the body. This is because removing any kind of hair from the body implies luxury and elegance, which contradict the spirit of the state of ihram, in which a pilgrim is supposed to be unkempt and dusty. It is permissible, however, to remove any unusual hair that is abnormally around the eye or on the eyelid without any expiation. So now, if you had a valid excuse to remove something that unwanted and something that should not be there, then there is no problem, inshallah ta'ala, and there is no expiation for that. The Sheikh said, this is because it is not a normal place for hair to grow, and by removing it, one spare oneself harm and pain. The second, a muhrim is a person in a state of ihram, is prohibited to clip one's fingernails or two nails without any legal excuse. And if you look at it, like there is a connection between the pilgrims and those who are not performing Umrah and Hajj, us. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, when the moon of Dhul Hijjah comes in, when it comes upon you, then, and one of you intends to slaughter, then it is not permissible for him to shave his hair or to cut his nails. So what if someone did it unintentionally? Then there is no problem, inshallah. There is no sin upon the person. And even if he did it intentionally, all he could do is make istighfar, seek forgiveness. This is for the one who is not performing Hajj and Umrah. They don't have to make an expiation. But for the pilgrim, if he forgot, for example, or she forgot, there is nothing upon them. But if they did not forget, they did it intentionally, then they have to do one of the three. Either they sacrifice a lamb and they distribute the meat among the poor people of Mecca, or they feed six poor people. Each one of them gets half a sa'. And a sa' equals to about 3 kilograms. 3 kilograms. So half a sa' will be 1.5 kilos of rice, barley, or anything like that. Or the person can fast 3 days. So any of these would suffice as an expiation if someone was to do any of the prohibitions of Ihram, except for the marital relations, and it's going to come up, inshallah ta'ala, and we're going to study that as well. The Sheikh, he said, without any legal excuse. So if there was a legal excuse, yet if a nail is broken and one has to clip it or to remove it with part of its skin, it is permissible for one to do so without any expiation for that. Like, for example, your nail broken and it was bothering you and things like that, and then you remove it, there is no expiation because it's something you're removing harm from your body. The Sheikh, he said, it is permissible for one to do so without any expiation for that.
This is because it is removed as a consequence of being broken. As for the skin, it is related to the nail because it's part of it. And that, and thus the same ruling is applicable. And this is a very good qa'ida, ikhwan, very good foundation in al-fiqh. They call it at-tabi'. Like, for example, the skin is part of the skin comes with the nail, itself. So it has the same ruling. Like, for example, if someone was to sell a camel, a pregnant she-camel, or a pregnant cow, and he cannot say, well, I'm going to sell you the cow, and then we're going to do a transaction for the fetus. We say to him, no, at-tabi', because the baby comes with the mother. So you pay for the whole package. This is a very important, and when you buy a house, you buy the garden in the house as well, and anything that is part of the house, including the doors and the windows and everything. At-tabi', because those have the same ruling as the house itself. So because they're part of it. طيب. The Sheikh, he said, Hafidhahullah ta'ala, in addition, it is permissible to remove the hair of the head if it causes any harm such as lice or headache. For Allah exalted be He says, the meaning of which, and whoever amongst you is ill or has an ailment of the head, making shaving necessary, must offer a ransom of fasting 3 days or charity or sacrifice. This is exactly what I mentioned a little bit earlier. So these three things, these are called kafara, a ransom, or fidya, you can call it fidya also. And it is either fasting 3 days or charity, which is feeding six poor people. Each one gets half a sa', 1 kilo and a half of rice or anything like that. If you cook it, it's even better. Or a sacrificial animal that you slaughter and you distribute among the poor people of Mecca. This is in Surah Al-Baqarah, Ayah 196. Also, Ka'b ibn Ujra reported, he's one of the companions. He said, there was an ailment in my head, and I was carried to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam while lice were scattering over my face. Upon that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to me, I have never imagined that your ailment has reached such an extent as I see. Can you afford a sheep? I replied, no. Thereupon, the following verse was revealed. And whoever amongst you is ill or has an ailment of the head, making shaving necessary, must offer a ransom of fasting 3 days or charity or a sacrifice. Surah Al-Baqarah 196. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to me, fast for 3 days or feed six needy people or slaughter a sheep in expiation for shaving the hair of the head despite ihram. The permissibility here is because the ailment is caused by lice, not by the hair itself. So by an outside factor, which is the lice. It's very important. Moreover, it is permissible for the muhrim to wash his hair with sidr, the extract of the low tree leaves, and the like. For it is narrated in the two sahih that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam washed his head while being in a state of ihram, moving his hand forward and backward through his head. Sheikh al-Islam Taqiyuddin Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala said, scholars unanimously, means there is ijma', there is unanimous agreement, agree that it is permissible for a muhrim to take a bath to purify from al-janaba, a major ritual impurity in case of having a wet dream during ihram, or for any other reason. The third, a male muhrim. So now the Sheikh is very specific. A male, this excludes the female. A male muhrim is prohibited to cover his head. So you cannot wear, like for example, a cap. You cannot wear a kufi, for example. Anything that sticks to the head. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited wearing a turban, hood, or anything of the kind while being in a state of ihram. In this regard, the great Muslim scholar, Ibn al-Qayyim, may Allah have mercy on him, said, there is consensus that everything that touches the head with the purpose of covering it, such as a turban, a cap, a hat, or anything else is prohibited during ihram. This is applicable to all sorts of head covers, be it something usual, such as turban, or unusual, such as a paper, mud, henna, or headband. A muhrim can seek the shelter of a tent, a tree, or a house. For it was narrated that a tent was pitched for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to take shelter therein while being in a state of ihram. On the other hand, it is permissible for a muhrim to use an umbrella for shading only when necessary. Likewise, it is permissible for a muhrim to ride a car with a roof or carry his luggage above his head, provided not for the purpose of covering the head. So as long as everything depends on the intention of that person. The fourth, it is also prohibited for a male muhrim to wear sewn clothes. So the female, they can wear sewn clothes. So when he said male, this excludes the female. Sewn clothes to cover all of parts or all or parts of the body, such as shirt, turban, or a pair of trousers. Similarly, it is prohibited for a male muhrim to wear anything made exactly to fit a certain part of the body, such as shoes, gloves, or socks. It is narrated in the two sahih that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked what a muhrim should wear, he sallallahu alaihi wasallam said a muhrim should not wear a shirt or a turban or a hooded cloak or a pair of trousers or a cloth touched with alwars. Alwars is a yellow good smelled plant used for dyeing. So anything has an aroma, has a nice fragrance to it, it is not permissible for a muhrim to put it on. He can put it on before ihram, when he is at the miqat, after he showers and get cleaned up and everything. Then you can put your perfume on your body, also on your ihram is okay. But after you make the intention for ihram, for umrah and hajj, then it is not permissible to do that. Or with saffron. Nor should he wear khufs, leather socks or shoes. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited muhrims to wear shirts, hooded cloaks, trousers, and khuf or turbans. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also forbade them to cover the head of a male muhrim in case he died. So when someone died in umrah, performing umrah and hajj, while he's still in that state of ihram, we don't cover the head of that person. We don't cover the head of that person. And ordered the man who assumed the ihram while wearing a jubba. Jubba is a cloak, to take it off. So wearing anything similar to a jubba on the pretext that it is not a jubba is regarded as dishonest interpretation of what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbade. A muhrim is also prohibited to wear something similar to a shirt, be it with or without sleeves, or new or torn. The same prohibition applies to wearing jubba or a cloak in whose sleeves one passes one's hand. You know what I'm talking about. You can run your hands through it. That's called jubba, cloak. Ibn Taymiyyah then continued, this is the juristic meaning of not wearing sewn clothing while being in a state of ihram. Sewn clothing is any garment made to fit a certain part of the body. Therefore, a muhrim is not to wear anything similar to trousers, such as shorts and the like. However, if a muhrim does not find a suitable pair of slippers, he may wear khufs, leather socks or shoes. And if he does not find a suitable loin cloth, he may wear a pair of trousers until he finds a suitable one. Once the muhrim finds a proper loincloth, he must take off the trousers and wear it as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave permission for male muhrims over Mount Arafah to wear trousers if they do not find a loincloth. As far as a female muhrim, she may wear whatever clothes she likes while being in a state of ihram, for she must be covered well. Still, she is not allowed to wear burqu'. Al-burqu' is a veil covering the face and has two holes for the eyes to permit vision. So a female muhrim is not to wear al-burqu', but she is to cover her face with other things such as al-khimar, a shawl-like cloth, covering the head and the shoulders, and a gown. Moreover, a female muhrim should not wear gloves to cover her hand. For the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith related by al-Bukhari and other compilers of hadith, a female muhrim must not wear a niqab, a face-covering veil, nor must she wear gloves. In this connection, Imam al-Qayyim, rahimahullah ta'ala, said the Prophet's prohibition for female pilgrims of covering their faces or wearing gloves indicate that a woman's face is treated as a man's body. So, the man's body, you're not supposed to, for example, we're not supposed to cover our head, for example, but the woman is not supposed to cover her face and also not to wear gloves, made specifically for certain parts of the body. Similarly, a female muhrim is not to cover her face with a specific face cover, such as a niqab or a face covering veil or a burqa'. However, she should cover her face with a veil which shows only her face and a gown according to the more valid of the two juristic opinions in this regard. The gloves are specifically made for the hands to protect them from cold. A female muhrim is primarily obliged to hide her face from the eyes of the men, and this is not through wearing a burqa'. To illustrate, Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, narrated, men would pass by us when we accompanied Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam while we were in the state of Ihraam, a state of ritual consecration during Hajj or Umrah. When they came by us, every one of us would let down her gown over her face. And when they had passed on, we would uncover our faces, related by Imam Ahmed, Abu Dawood, and other compilers of hadith. There is no harm if the face cover of a female pilgrim touches her face, as she is just forbidden from wearing a burqa' or niqab, not from covering her face with something else. Sheikh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala said, a female pilgrim should not bother keeping her face covered separate from her face, either with a small piece of wood or with her hand or with anything else. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made the hand and the face of a woman equal in this case, i.e. they are permitted to be uncovered, and both of them should be regarded as the male pilgrim's body, not his head. Moreover, the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to cover their faces without having to keep the cover away from their faces. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala said, it is permissible for her, i.e. female pilgrim, to cover her face with any face cover that touches the face, provided it is neither a niqab nor a burqa. As long as it is not niqab and burqa, it is permissible. The fifth, it is prohibited for a muhrim to wear perfume, whether on the body or on the clothing of ihram, or even to use it in food or beverages. So those food that have like an aroma, have a fragrance, like have saffron or something like that, biryani or something like that, then it is not permissible for a muhrim to eat those type of food. Or to drink tea that has saffron in it or something, an aroma in it. For the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to a man in the state of ihram to take off his cloak and to wash away the traces of perfume from his body. Likewise, he sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to the people about the muhrim who fell down from his mount and broke his neck and died. He said, do not apply any perfume to him. The idea behind the prohibition of wearing perfume during ihram is to detach oneself from luxury and worldly ornament and pleasures, and to draw one's attention to the hereafter. It is also impermissible for a pilgrim to smell perfumes on purpose or rub the body with a perfume substance. So if that was done without any intention to do it, then there is no problem, inshallah. Six, a muhrim is also prohibited to kill game animals. as Allah exalted be, he says, the meaning of which, O you who have believed, do not kill game while you are in the state of Ihraam. Surah Al-Ma'idah, ayah 95. That is, do not kill game in the state of Ihraam to perform Hajj or Umrah. Allah exalted be, he also says, the meaning of which, but forbidden to you is game from the land. In other words, if it is from the sea, like fish, you can go fishing and stuff, that's okay. But anything from the land, because he said, but forbidden to you is game from the land, as long as you are in a state of ihram. That is to say, those in a state of ihram are forbidden to hunt or to kill game animals or help in hunting or slaughtering them. Likewise, it is prohibited for a muhrim to eat a game animal which he hunted, which was hunted for him, or which he helped in hunting, as it will be regarded as a dead animal in this case, which is unlawful to eat. Still, it is not prohibited for a muhrim to eat fish or animals from the sea, whether he hunts it or anyone else does it for him. As Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, the meaning of which, lawful to you is game from the sea and its food. Surah Al-Ma'idah, ayah 96. On the other hand, it is permissible for a muhrim to slaughter a domestic animal, because what's not permissible is a wild animal, like a zebra or a gazelle or something like that. But if it is only domestic animal, like a chicken or something like that, then it's permissible, inshallah ta'ala. Like such as chicken, sheep, and cattle. And they are not game animals, because they're not considered game animals. The muhrim is also permitted to kill wild, inedible animals. Wild, inedible animals like lions and tigers and the like. So it is not permissible for such creatures threatened. It's permissible to kill them, because such creatures, they threaten people's lives, so you can kill them. Generally, if a muhrim has to do any of the act prohibited during ihram for a legal excuse, he or she is permitted to do it, provided he or she is to slaughter a sacrificial animal in expiation. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and whoever amongst you is ill or has an ailment of the head, making shaving necessary, must offer a ransom of fasting 3 days, or charity or sacrifice. So there are three options here that Allah mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 196. The seventh, a muhrim is prohibited to marry while being in a state of ihram, or arrange the marriage of another by guardianship. So you cannot act as a guardian, like someone wants to get married or the like, while you are, even if they were not in a state of ihram. As long as you are in a state of ihram, then it is not permissible for you to do that. As al-Imam Muslim related on the authority of Uthman ibn Affan, radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, a muhrim must neither marry himself nor arrange the marriage of another one. The eighth, a muhrim is prohibited to have sexual intercourse, for Allah exalted be, he says, the meaning of which, so whoever has made Hajj obligatory upon himself therein by entering the state of ihram, there is to be for him no sexual relations. فَمَنْ فَرَضَ فِيهِنَّ الْحَجِّ فَلَا رَفَتَ وَلَا فُسُوقَ وَلَا جِدَالَ فِي الْحَجِّ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, the meaning of which, so whoever enters into that state of ihram, then there is no marital relations, and there is no sinning, and there is no dispute or argumentation while you are in a state of hajj, a state of ihram. And the hadith Prophet sallam, he said alayhi salatu wassalam, in the sound hadith, whoever performs hajj and he does not commit any sexual relations with his wife, he does not have any marital relations with his wife, and he does not sin, and he does not cause any dispute or start dispute or argumentation, then he will return back as the day his mom gave birth to him, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will wipe off all his sins, including the major sins as well. And that's why Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, when he gave the pledge of allegiance to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, O Messenger of Allah, I have a condition. So the Prophet, he said, what is your condition? He said, I will give the pledge of allegiance, provided that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives my sins. So then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَمَا عَلِمْتَ يَا عَمْرُ أَنَّ الْإِسْلَامَ يَهْدِمُ مَا قَبْلَهُ وَأَنَّ الْهِجْرَةَ تَهْدِمُ مَا قَبْلَهَا وَأَنَّ الْحَجَّ يَهْدِمُ مَا قَبْلَهُ. He said, don't you know, يَا عَمْرُ, Amr ibn al-As, he said, don't you know that Islam wipes off everything a person did in the past? So if someone comes to Islam, he was a non-Muslim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives everything a person did in the past. And don't you know, Ya Amr, that al-hijra, migrating for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the land of the non-Muslim to the land of the Muslims, wipes off all the sins. And don't you know, Ya Amr, this is the point of reference, that when you perform Hajj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wipes off all your sins. It's a great benefit for all of us, for especially those who have not performed Al-Hajj yet. The Sheikh, he said, according to Ibn Abbas, it refers to the activity of engaging in sexual intercourse. To clarify, if a man in a state of Ihraam, i.e. Muhrim, has sexual intercourse with his wife before the first release from Ihraam, it will invalidate his Hajj. What the Sheikh is talking about, the first release, Ikhwan, because there is the first, brothers and sisters, the first release and the second release. Okay, طيب. The first release is when you leave Muzdalifa and you come to Mina for Rami al-Jamarat, Rami al-Pelt, pelting with the pebbles, the seven consecutive pebbles. With each one you say Allahu Akbar, consecutive. So when you come to Mina, you go to al-Jamarat al-Aqaba, which is the biggest Jamara. Because al-Jamarat, there are three. You have the biggest one, which is closer to Mecca, and then you have the middle one, and you have the small one. So on the day of Eid, the 10th of the Hijjah, you do three things. The first, Rami al-Jamarat, pelting, the seven pebbles, with each one a takbira. Seven takbirat. So this is called Jamarat al-Aqaba. Jamarat al-Aqaba. This is the biggest one. So after this, you do the slaughter animal. You slaughter the animal, the sacrificial animal. And then after that, you shave. For the man, is shaving is better. Because the Prophet ﷺ, he made dua for those who shave. So shaving is better. For the woman, she clips only the size of a fingertip. That's it for the woman. She holds her hair together and she cut the size of a fingertip. But for the man, it's better to shave. You can shorten, but shaving is better because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made dua for those who shave. So shaving is better, barakallahu fikum, for the males. So when you do these three, this you are half released from your ihram. So the Sheikh is talking about a man who had relations with his wife before he did these three. So what happened to his Hajj? His Hajj is null void, is gone completely. Okay, now question. Does this man have to continue with the rites of Hajj? Does he have to complete and finish? Yes, he has to. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, he said, وَأَتِمُّ الْحَجَّ وَالْعُمْرَةَ لِلَّهِ, and complete Hajj and Umrah for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he has to continue and finish Nusuk, the rites of Hajj. And the coming year, he has to perform Hajj again because his Hajj is gone completely. طيب. So, but if he did it after the first release, he did the three. Rami al-Jamarat, remember? Rami al-Jamarat, pelting the pebbles, seven consecutive ones with takbir on each one. And the sacrificial animal and the shaving. And then after that, he had relations with his wife. Okay, now his Hajj is valid, is still valid. But he violated his Ihram. So what is he supposed to do here? okay? He's supposed to sacrifice a lamb. He's supposed to sacrifice a lamb as an expiation for that. And also, because he violated his ihram, he has to go out to the nearest miqat, to the nearest point, and then assume his ihram and come to Mecca and do tawaf al-ifada, the tawaf of al-hajj with sa'i between Safa wal Marwa. Is that clear? But in the case of the first one, because he had relations before the first release, before the three that I mentioned, then he invalidated his hajj. His hajj is gone. So he has to redo it again. But he has to complete the rites of hajj. Plus, he has to expiate either a camel or a cow. I think that's clear, inshallah ta'ala. The sheikh, he said, حفظه الله ta'ala, it's obligatory for him to continue performing the rest of the rite of Hajj. For Allah exalted be, he says, وَأَتِمُّ الْحَجَّ وَالْعُمْرَةَ لِلَّهِ in Surah Al-Baqarah. And complete Hajj and Umrah for Allah. Still, it is obligatory for such a person to re-perform Hajj the following year and to slaughter a camel or a cow. On the other hand, if a muhrim has sexual intercourse with his wife after the first release, after he did the three, remember, of Ihram, his Hajj is still considered valid, provided that he slaughtered the sheep in expiation. But Sheikh Al-Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, he mentioned another benefit. He said he has to go to the nearest miqat and assume al-ihram from there and come to Mecca, the Masjid al-Haram, do the tawaf of Hajj and the sa'i between Safa and Marwa. By doing this, then relationship is halal for him now. So this is the second release. When you do the tawaf, which is tawaf and sa'i, which is a pillar of Hajj, The ninth, a muhrim is prohibited to touch his wife or any woman lustfully, such as kissing or the like, as these are among the acts that lead to sexual intercourse. Therefore, the muhrim must avoid sexual intercourse, lewdness, and dispute. For Allah exalted be, he says, the meaning of which, in Surah Al-Baqarah, فَمَنْ فَرَضَ فِيهِنَّ الْحَجِّ فَلَا رَفَتَ وَلَا فُسُوقَ وَلَا جِدَالَ فِي الْحَجِّ. So whoever has made Hajj obligatory upon himself therein, by entering the state of Ihram, there is to be for him no sexual relations, la rafat, and no disobedience, la fusuq, and no disputing during Hajj, wala jidal. The verse refers to the actual sexual intercourse and any related matters that might lead to it, such as kissing, touching, and talking about it. Disobedience is in the aforesaid verse means committing sins, which is a grave act to do while being in a state of ihram. Whereas a Muslim is supposed to be in a state of devotion and supplication. As for disputing, which is prohibited for a muhrim, it refers to arguing about matters that do not concern one, quarreling with one's pilgrim's mate, insulting others, etc. However, it is permissible for a muhrim to argue for the sake of showing the right, enjoining good. If you see someone innovating in the religion, and then you go, you say, "Akhi, this is bid'ah, don't do this," and he start arguing with you, and you dispute with him in a good manner to clarify this issue to him, there is no problem, because you will be rewarded for doing that. You'll be rewarded for doing that, inshallah ta'ala, because that's from enjoining good and forbidding evil. The sheikh said, however, it is permissible for muhrim to argue for the sake of showing the right, enjoining good, or forbidding evil. For arguments is a divine command. In such cases, Allah exalted be, he says, and argue with them in a way that is better. وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِي أَحْسَنِ, and argue with them in a way that is the best. That is the best. Surah An-Nahl, Ayah 125. It is an act of the Sunnah, prophetic tradition, for the muhrim to talk less, except in matters of benefit. It is narrated in the two Sahih on the authority of Abu Huraira, radiallahu anhu, who said, The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, he who believes in Allah and the last day should either say something good or keep silent. He sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in marfu' traceable hadith, a sign of one's good observance of Islam is leaving alone what does not concern him. Min husni Islam al-mar'i tarkuhu ma la ya'ni, is the hadith. It is also recommended for a muhrim to be preoccupied with chanting at-talbiyah. Talbiyah, labbayk Allahumma labbayk, labbayk la sharika laka labbayk, inna alhamda wa ni'mata laka wal mulk, la sharika laka. It's very easy, alhamdulillah, to memorize. Praising Allah, saying alhamdulillah, praising Allah. Reciting the Quran, enjoining what is good, forbidding what is evil, forbidding what is evil, and not wasting his time in what is useless. A muhrim should also perform hajj devoutly with sincere intention, seeking Allah's great rewards, as the muhrim is about to perform a great act of worship and visit great sacred precincts and shrines. Then, if a muhrim reaches Mecca with the intention of tamattu', he is to begin with performing the umrah rites as follows. A muhrim begins with performing at-tawaf, circumambulating the Kaaba, 7 times. Afterwards, he is to offer 2 rak'at, units of prayer, which are recommended to be performed at the standing place of Ibrahim, Maqam Ibrahim, if possible. Otherwise, the muhrim can perform them elsewhere in the mosque. Then, al-muhrim is the head for Safa to perform a sa'i, going between Safa and al-Marwa, 7 times, starting from Safa and ending at al-Marwa. The way from the one of them to the other is considered 1 time. From going from Safa to al-Marwa is 1 lap. And from al-Marwa to Safa is another lap. 7. And the way back is another. During sa'i, a pilgrim is recommended to be preoccupied with supplicating and in invoking Allah, glorified be He. After finishing the 7th round of sa'i, a male muhrim must shave all his head, and a female pilgrim should cut a small part equivalent to a fingertip of the hair of the head. In this way, a pilgrim will have accomplished al-umrah rites, so he exits the state of ihram, and thus is allowed to do all lawful acts that have been prohibited while being in a state of ihram, such as lawful sexual intercourse, wearing perfume, wearing sewn clothes, clipping the fingernails, trimming the mustache, and plucking out the hair of the armpits if necessary. A pilgrim remains in this condition until the day of Tarwiyah, the 8th day of the month of the Hijjah. Then he declares his intention of performing Hajj, as will be pointed out in details later. We already been through this with the Al-Allama Sheikh Muhammad bin Salih Al-Uthaymeen. Up to here, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all beneficent knowledge and righteous action. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim.